Welcome to our daily devotion. The Methodist Church of Barbados invites you to sing, pray, and worship with us as we declare God's glory and celebrate His mighty acts.
Father and our God, your mercies are new every morning. And we come this evening, Lord, to thank you for this day, to thank you for your gracious mercies that you bestowed on us this day, from morning until night. Gracious God, we thank you for taking us through this day, helping us, O God, to bear whatever burden comes our way. Father God, we thank you for your grace and your mercy. We can do nothing without it. And you said, O Lord, in your word that if we believe in you and call on your name, you will hear us. So Father, we come to give you thanks and praise for preserving us through this day, helping us to persevere and to live our lives, O God, according to your word, because you are a lamp unto our feet and a light unto our path. Gracious God, we ask you, O God, that you would continue to guide us through the night. We ask you, O Lord, that you will be with us and you will preserve us, O Lord. Help us to continue to come to you in faith. Help us, O Lord, to be able to live out your word. Gracious God, this day we ask you that you remember us in your mercy, all those who are ill and ailing. Father God, we ask that you will pour out your spirit upon them. Remember in your mercies, O Lord, all those who have lost loved ones and are grieving. Gracious God, as we come to this devotion tonight, we ask you, O Lord, that you will bless the one who brings your word, dear God, and that it will be a nourishment to our souls. Father in heaven, we pray for all the leaders, from the bishop, ministers, the lay preachers, O God, and you will bless them and continue to help them as we go forward, O Lord. Help us as a church, O Lord, to be supportive of them and to lift them up. Gracious God, we bring also to you this night the children. We ask you that you will be with and among the children in our schools, the teachers, and the parents, O God, because they are our future. They are the next generation, O God. We ask you, Father, to continue to bless and guide them. As you said in your word, you rebuke your disciples and ask them to leave the children that they may come unto you. So help us, O Lord, to be great examples for them. Gracious God, there's so much happening in the world and around the world today. But help us, O God, not to focus on the bad or the evil, but to be merciful and to continue to thank you for the mercies you have bestowed upon us. Because in every bad situation, we can see something good, because you have given us the strength to endure, to endure and to persevere and to make amends, O God. So, Father, we pray your mercies upon us this night. We pray your mercies on all your ministering servants. And we ask you, O God, that as we go to our beds tonight, you will go with us. And if it be your will to see another day, we know that you will see us through. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen.
I will sing of my Redeemer and his wondrous love to me. On the cruel cross he suffered from the curse to set me free. Sing, oh sing. Thank you.
Bible reading is taken from 2 Corinthians 5, 16 to 21. From now on, therefore, we regard no one from a human point of view. Even though we once knew Christ from a human point of view, we no longer know him in that way. So, if anyone is in Christ, there is a new creation. Everything old has passed away. Look, new things have come into being. All this is from God, who reconciled us to himself through Christ and has given us the ministry of reconciliation. That is, in Christ, God was reconciling the world to himself, not counting their trespasses against them, and entrusting the message of reconciliation to us. So we are ambassadors for Christ. Since God is making his appeal through us, we entreat you on behalf of Christ. Be reconciled to God. For our sake, God made the one who knew no sin to be sin, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. This is the word of God.
And now, O God, may the words of my mouth and the meditation of all our hearts together be acceptable in your sight, for you are our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Sisters and brothers, this evening, the theme for our reflection is God reconciled with the world. And I take as my focus the latter part of verse 17 of our text, which is found in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, the latter part of verse 17, which says, "See, everything has become new." My sisters and brothers, as we approach the penitential season of Lent, most of us go into a reflective mode as we contemplate what the crucifixion of Jesus Christ meant for us all. As we reflect, we need to call to mind that we human beings were created for eternal fellowship with God. At the time of creation, God made it known to humankind the reason for us being here, the responsibility of us all, and the regard which was expected for God our Creator and His law. He did not hide or hold back anything. He made it clear that we belong to Him and that He intended all that was good for us. He even appointed us as stewards over the land, which made us accountable to Him. But He went on to explain the consequences of disobedience and disregard to His law as death. A couple of weeks ago, a stark reminder that we belong to God came when, at the beginning of the new year, we renewed our covenant with God. The vows started with the words, "I am no longer my own. I belong to you." Whenever I think of those words, I ask myself, how can we now stand and boldly say those words when we, through original sin, disobeyed God and were separated from Him? How can we now make such a brazen claim? My friends, I want to let you know that it was only through Jesus Christ and His atoning death and glorious resurrection that we can make such a claim. And so, I want to share a few thoughts with you on how God was able to reconcile the world to Himself, and how we were able to transition from a state of separation to a stage of securely trusting on God and God alone, and on His Son Jesus Christ for our salvation. In doing so, I want to look at the three following points. One, it required a supreme intervention. Two, it required a sinless, spotless substitution. Three, it requires a surrender of self in response. My sisters and brothers, some of the most frequently asked questions at this time are, why did Jesus have to die such a cruel death? Was there no other way? How could the God of love allow this to happen? I must admit that I do not have the answers to such questions, as only God can explain the mystery of the Passion. However, when we look at the past failed attempts at reconciliation, we can only conclude that it required supreme intervention. In the past, the people were made to offer animal sacrifices, to be sprinkled, to sit in sackcloth and ashes, among other ritualistic practices. Yet, the people continued to do what was evil and displeasing to God. It reached a stage where God, through the prophet Amos, declared the following as found in Amos chapter 5, verses 21 to 23. I despise your festivals, and I take no delight in your solemn assemblies. Even though you offer me your burnt offerings and grain offerings, I will not accept them. And the offerings of well-being of your fatted animals, I will not look upon. Take away from me the noise of your songs. I will not listen to the melody of your harps. It was time for God to intervene with the plan of redemption, which was made from the beginning of creation. For God somehow knew that mankind would not make a wise choice and so would need to be rescued. Another prophet, Jeremiah, had this to say in the book of Jeremiah, chapter 31, verses 31 to 33. The days are surely coming, says the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and the house of Judah. It will not be like the covenant that I made with their ancestors when I took them by the hand to bring them out of the land of Egypt. A covenant that they broke, though I was their husband, says the Lord. But this is the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days, says the Lord. I will put my law within them, and I will write it on their hearts, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people. My friends, things had to be made new. This was also echoed in the book of Revelations, chapter 21, in the latter part of verse 5, which says, "See, I am making all things new." The old account had to be settled once and for all. Jesus had to come on earth in human form to undertake a rescue mission. It required a supreme intervention. On the second point, for reconciliation to take place, there had to be an acceptable substitution for the animals which were sacrificed under the old dispensation. In the new dispensation, one sacrifice had to be made for all times. Only Jesus, the sinless one, could fit the bill. The poet Isaac Watts, in hymn 234 in the Methodist hymn book, puts it this way in verses 1 and 2. "Not all the blood of beasts on Jewish altars slain could give the guilty conscience peace or wash away the stain. But Christ, the heavenly Lamb, takes all our sins away, a sacrifice of nobler name and richer blood than they." In the final verse, which is verse 5, it says, "Believing, we rejoice to see the curse removed. We bless the Lamb with cheerful voice and sing his bleeding love." My sisters and brothers, another hymn writer in the hymn, "There's a Green Hill Far Away," in verse 4 puts it this way: "There was no other good enough to pay the price of sin. He only could unlock the gate of heaven and let us in." What beautiful reminders we have in song. But we are also mindful of this in scripture. For in our focal text for this evening in the book of 2 Corinthians chapter 5 at verse 21, we find the words, "For our sake, God made the one who knew no sin to be sin, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God." My friends, a substitution had to be made for reconciliation to take place. Jesus was the only one preeminently qualified for the task. This brings me to my third point, which is that of our surrender as a response to all of what Jesus has done. In the first place, Jesus willingly surrendered his life like a lamb to the slaughter. Why then are we finding it difficult to surrender to him? You see, my friends, in making things new, it may require a stripping away, a reclothing, a melting down and a reshaping, a realignment, and being redirected. Perhaps some of us may be afraid of the process, but look what it costs the Master, and think upon the marvelous outcome. It costs his life and his joy. That is why we need to surrender to him. For in the book of Hebrews, chapter 12, verse 2, we are reminded, "Looking to Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of faith, who for the sake of the joy that was set before him endured the cross, disregarding its shame, and has taken his seat at the right hand of God. All we have to do is by faith to accept him. Through the working power of the Holy Spirit, he will make all things new. It is only when we are transformed in the image of Christ that we can truly say, I am no longer my own. I belong to you. It is only when we are reconciled and transformed in the likeness of Christ that we can become his ambassadors, for our voice and our actions should reflect his. Most importantly, his will now becomes our wills. His way now becomes our way. And his words now become our words. These, my friends, are the hallmarks of being a new creation, a change of heart and mind. As I conclude, I want to remind you, myself included, that there is one and only one reason why God, through Jesus Christ, has been reconciled with the world. This is summed up in that familiar verse found in John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, so that everyone who believes in him may not perish, but may have eternal life. His love for us merits a response from us. Our response will lead to that newness which will not only make our joy in him complete, but will also make us replete to be his ambassadors. So that if the question is asked, who is on the Lord's side? We can readily respond in the words of that same hymn, numbered 325 in our voices in praise, which says, by thy great redemption, by thy grace divine, we are on the Lord's side. Savior, we are thine. In that response, it is made clear that we are blood-bought and blood-washed Christians who are renewed in Christ and committed as his ambassadors to bring about transformation in our region. May we then, as the reconciled and the transformed, bear fruit worthy of repentance, not only during the penitential season of Lent, but for all our lives. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let us pray. Almighty God, thank you for reconciling us to yourself. Thank you for the redeeming love of your Son, Jesus Christ, who made it all possible by his sacrificial death on the cross. I pray that as we continue to serve and to trust you, that you will continue the work of grace in us, so that we too can be changed from glory into glory, till in heaven we see your face. Sustaining and keeping God, help us never to be ashamed of the gospel and what it means to say redeemed by the blood of the Lamb, his child, and forever I am. God our Father, may we then be willing to minister to others as your ambassadors, knowing that with you, our labors will not be in vain. And so, may the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be with us all this day and forevermore. Amen.
Thank you for being a part of our daily devotion. We trust it has been a blessing to you. Now together, Let us hold fast to his word, and may it dwell in all of us richly.